bad, but
yeah, and the control was there.
The poise, man.
Mm-hmm.
That was.
Hey,
that
you
was
could
key.
Honestly tell they let Aloha Dance go because they saw the other people coming in. They're like, "Here come our big targets. Let's get them instead." Great captaining, man. The guy knows what he's doing.
He does.
Gotta keep the eye out.
Let's see if he knows what he's doing in the next draft as well. We are actually in the draft of game number two at Finem, indeed on the Radiant side, and taking over Virtus.Pro once again. They are one game up, and at Finem, therefore, already $1,000 in the bag. Let's see if they can make it 2,000 as they first pick Io.
Wow.
Io was ignored.
I'm guessing that second ban I did was Bounty, correct?
What?
Was the second ban at Finem did Bounty?
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry, the ban so far, Chen, Nature's Prophet on the side of Virtus.Pro, and Earth Spirit and Bounty on the side of Adfinim.
Okay, then it makes sense.
I'm starting to like Adfinim. They don't give a hoot about when they pick their heroes.
They want to play
like,
their plan.
Forget
that's what I'm saying, man.
Take it.
You, whatever you feel like you're good with, you play that. It's like, okay, the other team's pushing. I don't care. This is the heroes that we want to play. We think it's good. We practice with it. We're confident. Let's go. 5 seconds. That's how you got
to
be.
It's a good way to win, apparently, as we just saw last time. Very confident in all their heroes, so who are they going to pair with that Wisp? Usually it's a tiny is what people
Lots
like these
of
days.
Options, yeah. But... I mean, Sven is obviously good, CK is good, Gyrocopter is good.
The fabled Beastmaster lately.
Yeah, Beastmaster can definitely be a thing as well.
Yeah.
But the Beastmaster is a hero that is more like the we set up for the relocate.
Okay.
You know, like we roar a target, then you relocate in.
Mm.
And that's how you get your kills. It was similar to what people were doing with like this offlane morphling before it got nerfed.
Mm-hmm.
You would like adaptive strike and it's a 4.5 second stun.
Yeah.
So it gives you ample time to just go in, get the kill, back out, etc. So
God, that stun's annoying.
It is mega annoying.
And
there it is. The Rock, man.
Well, classic Wisp Tiny combo, so they got a lot to be worried about now. They can be initiated on any time, and especially with the Enchantress, that burst damage coming out of nowhere.
Yeah, you go splat.
Yep.
At the same time, it's also very predictable what they go for here. That you can, you've got all the time in the world to prepare for an IO-10 combination, so you can get your Witch Doctor, you can get your Disruptor, if you want to have either of those, and they are very good support counters.
That's going against Andy's idea. Why pick Disruptor? You know, just because he's a good counter to IO Tiny.
Oh,
go with
Virtus
what you
Pro,
like, man.
Virtus.Pro likes Disruptor.
Yeah, they do actually.
Well, so it could be a thing. It could be a thing. It's one of those situations where sometimes a combination kind of demands a response, but normally what happens is the team is experienced with some heroes that respond to the problem. You know, it's not like, oh, we have to pick a hero we've never played before.
Yeah.
It's more just like, it might not necessarily be exactly what we want, but we can deviate a tiny bit. Like one or two hero deviation is normally okay. When you start getting to the third and fourth pick and you think, okay, we have a really bad plan, that's when it starts to get troublesome. You just don't ever want to be in that spot. But I feel like both these teams have a drafter and a captain who probably don't put themselves in that spot too much. I mean, you want to go back to really putting yourself in a corner. You have to look at the Shanghai Major, the finals.
Yeah.
And the very last game. That was drafting yourself into a corner.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Curl even said after, he's like, yeah, I made some mistakes.
Yeah.
And that's how you know. That's how you learn. And you're like, okay, I can't put myself in this position again.
Ban so far on the team from Adfinim are the Death Prophet and the Ursa. And the bans from Virtus.Pro are the Doom and Beastmaster. And they instantly pick up the OD there.
No, it's really strong, actually. OD against the relocate is strong because you can pretty much imprison whoever you want as soon as they come in. Normally, it's the Tiny, so you can kill the Wisp.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Tiny's left there all by himself. Same thing with Disruptor, really. It's just a core hero who obviously has really good lane matchups. Picking a Disruptor can be kind of a bad thing this early on because we haven't seen the offlane yet, and a lot of times Disruptor is not seen as a very good zoning hero.
No.
He's kind of weak in the trade, so... you said Furion was banned, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, he was first banned by Adfinim, if I remember
first
correctly.
First banned by Virtus.Pro, yeah.
Or, yeah, Virtus. Was it Virtus.Pro or?
Virtus.Pro is dire. They banned Nature's Prophet.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, Invoker, of course, a very good combination there with the Sunstrike and the TP and
Does
that
mean that we're going to see Io Tiny not mid?
Safe lane Invoker can be a thing, too.
Okay.
I think it's more common to see the Invoker safe lane in this scenario because you want Io to be able to go to either rune to fill a bottle.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to control at least one of them. And I mean, Invoker safe lane isn't really bad.
10 seconds.
And I guess Io Tiny safe lane isn't really bad either. It's just more common that you see the Wisp there because bottling is really the abuse that you want. And against an OD, you can also spam toss and whatnot, get him low on HP, maybe set up for a gank if you get lucky, depending on what other support they want to pick up.
Yeah, they're taking their time. I mean, at Finem, they ban out Ursa and Death Prophet, but it's not really to counter the Io Tiny combination per se.
Yeah.
We have Klinks still on the pool, by the way. That could be a nice hero for Virtus.Pro.
Yep. Klinks is really good, yeah. Unfortunately, they picked Void. Otherwise, I would say Brood would be amazing against this.
Why no Brood, then?
Well, because they have Void already.
Void's going to go offline.
Yeah. Ah. Unless it's that jungle Brood with an Iron Talon.
They already have an Enchantress, though.
They could safe lane the OD and put Brood mid.
They could. Call back the TI5 final. Yeah. C-Deck. Oh,
they
yeah.
could do that.
We could do it. Get that Iron Talon.
Can't you just relocate on the Brood
Wasn't
Dust
it
and
Secret
kill him?
Who did that?
Was it? No.
Wasn't it Zai who played Brood mid?
I thought it was C-Deck coming out with a pocket strat beating out.
I don't actually remember.
I don't remember.
I remember it very well. That was when I talked to Gabe Newell.
If I remembered all the drafts, I wouldn't need to write them down.
Rubik!
He's just out of here. What happens if they win again?
This will be my last day.
Alright. Confirmed. Rubik. Slacks will leave Dream League if a Rubik wins two games
Good.
In a row.
Great. Good to see him coming back again. That's awesome.
What is it about the hero that you dislike so much?
Nothing. He's a great hero. As we saw from the last game. Love him. He's always...
Is your world shattered because you just feel like every time you learn something about Dota, you just get completely destroyed?
I can't hold it in. Because
that's how I feel sometimes.
Every time I change an opinion about a hero, I lose something. I don't even remember what Omni Knight's ult is.
That's why
called.
Dota's a great game, because every time you think you know what's going on,
it's... Oh, something I know about. Oh, sweet boy.
Yeah.
When will you come back?
I think Omni's actually legit right now.
Really?
So, I mean, they have an
OD. Oh, they banned the Brood.
Oh,
they banned the Brood just now, yes.
Okay.
And they also banned Disruptor.
Oh my god. That would make... Come on, just give me an Omni pick for once.
Nah. Actually, with this lineup, they
could.
They could actually Omni
on Virtus.Pro. Yeah.
Oh my god.
It would be insane, but they could do it.
It's never insane. It's the easy win.
The easy win.
All right. So last pick for VP. What are your thoughts?
It's Omni.
Yeah, they're looking for a support. Could be Witch Doctor.
Witch Doctor and Disruptor's already banned out. So
wait, what are you guys talking about? Omni would be horrible. He's horrible against Rubik. Anything that Rubik takes from Omni is amazing.
This is what you do, right? You just literally repel the OD, and he hits buildings, and you just sit in fog.
True, but I mean, anything that Rubik can take anything from that Omni.
Yeah, of course. I mean, Rubik is good against Omni. I'm not arguing that.
Whoever,
I'm just saying that in the overall scheme of what they want to do, they're going to go back to the line. Okay.
The standard pick. Easy pick.
Yeah, I thought it might be... I mean, obviously, Lion Cell has good synergy with Sphere, but Witch Doctor is like the go-to when you think about Death Ward, obviously,
sure.
and Chronosphere.
Which last pick would you like for at Finem? I mean, in terms of offlaners that are generic, Darkseer is still in the pool.
What about Tide? Is Tide available?
Tide is still in the pool.
Tide might be nice. It's an often response to Void. When you see that hero, you want another hero with a decent AoE where you can kind of punish a Chronosphere or, you know, make him want a Chronosphere you.
Mm-hmm.
Which is also nice, because that way you know who he's going to be going for, but we'll see. Darkseer could be good, but there's not really anything to partner with, that's my only problem. And they don't have great combo heroes with a DS.
Vacuum into Avalanche?
Yeah, that's the only thing, right? Like, with the old Deafening? If it was old Deafening, I would say Darkseer would be really good still.
Mm.
But with new Deafening where it doesn't stun, it's kind of like...
Vacuum into Meatball?
That is the thing, yeah.
Oh,
if you landed a stun toss combo with that DS into a meatball, you just killed their whole team.
Batrider.
Oh, it's bad again. Okay.
Darn, I was going to pull a PPD and say go for the Pugna.
Wait, what?
Pugna, dude.
Pugna?
Hot hero.
They
right
already
now.
Have their mid.
Hot hero. Jungle Pugna. All you need is the Iron Talon.
All right.
Okay.
Whatever.
Whatever. Who's going to win this game? Gents, come.
I don't even know anymore.
I'm still going to stick to my guns and say 1-1. I'll 1-1. Say DP, take it back this game.
But Batrider.
I mean, Bat's good.
He did good, great last
he
game.
He did very good last
Skylark
game.
Bat.
But I still think VP are going to win.
I don't even know anymore.
Is Rubik going to win, Slacks? You got to say.
Yeah, he's going to win.
Rubik is going to win.
And now he's going to lose. And then the circle of pain will be complete for me.
Okay. So, which one would you feel is going to win?
Ad Finem.
Okay. It is a split panel here. We're going to find out what our commentators think. It
Please.
Is time for our last game of the evening. We have got ourselves at Finem and Virtus.Pro here with OD Pixel and PyCat.
Prepare for battle. Hello and welcome back to the final game of the final series of the day. We have, of course, once more, Ad Finem up against Virtus.Pro. That last game, that Virtus.Pro holding on, what was a 25k net loss for them at the end of the game, but they still managed to hold it out. This game, we're coming into a little bit of a switch up in the drafts. Something's staying the same, though. We're going to see FNG, of course, again on his Void. Worth noting as well, the OD, of course, G is going to be playing at this time rather than Yoku, who's managed to get himself the Gyrocopter. So some really strong kind of classic Virtus.Pro heroes. But Ad Finem, they've got the Tiny IO and they've got that bat again. And we did indeed, as they say, saw Skylark pull out some pretty nice plays on the bat. What are you thinking looking at these drafts, Pykett?
Oh, VB's lineup is kind of similar to last games. Mm. They don't have the same push per se. I mean, there's no Viper, but the lineup, the way it works, the idea behind the lineup is kind of the same. Void, lockdown, get a lot of ranged heroes who can deal a lot of damage, and you have the Odin there. Ad Finem, though, very interesting. Picking up Wisp, by the way, I mean, this feels kind of like a pre-planned strategy already. When you pick up a Wisp like that, just from the get-go, so going with the Wisp Tiny, they're going to run it safe lane. A bit interesting that they're actually opting to do that, because it might be difficult running the Wisp Tiny. I don't know, actually, you know, maybe they've run it a lot of times on the safe lane, but kind of, I would expect it to be a bit difficult against the Void Enchantress. I wouldn't have mind seeing it on the mid lane, but yeah, I mean, I'm sure they have an idea.
I can't remember the last time I saw a Tiny IO game where it wasn't mid. It just, that seems to be the go-to here. And I guess, as you said, they've just obviously got something in their mind that they wanted to have the Invoker as part of that. And obviously Invoker, not really your best safe laner, so.
Yeah, but I'm also curious though, and I think it's interesting that they pick up this Rubick once again, and I'm curious if it's against the OD or against the Void or kind of against both, because they both kind of have good spells to steal. And yeah, they seem to be lagging this Rubick. And I mean, it is really nice against the OD because you will always get that Astral unless he messes up and you get the ult, which is also obviously a very good spell to steal. So, you know, just alone from that, it could be a good pickup. But yeah, Ad Finem going with the strategy that they seem to know.
Yeah, I mean, this mid lane matchup this time around, we saw in the first game, of course, G picked up the Viper and it was very even farm, you know, a bit of a wash in the mid. Do we expect to see G kind of take more of a lead here on the OD this time?
Yeah, he also has the support of the Enchantress. Yeah. Potentially, they could rotate in the Wisp or and the Rubick and help out that Invoker, but I think G is he's a very good player in the lane, so I expect him to edge out the Invoker, and we already see he's up to 7-5. Invoker sitting at 2-2.
Yeah.
Bottom lane, we have the Void. He's gonna go for that four-man shield, taking a bit of harass. He should be able to sit in that lane.
Look at that. I mean, this mid laner, absolute nightmare. If they get the kill here, trying to get the vision, and they will now, but they can't seem to get G quite close enough. He's gonna pop the salve. He's trying to juke this out. No fear. Bit of a ring around the roses
here. Time here.
Yeah.
Yeah. He could have even turned around and popped the Force Spirit and blocked them in there, but just running around, it's fine. He's just wasting two heroes' time, so he's just winning by doing nothing at that point.
And I mean, it's MIT, the amount of right clicks he's given FNG, but as you said, FNG doesn't really care too much.
That's nice.
Now, this could maybe result in a kill with the Hex, the Rocket Barrage. Okay, IO coming in and now Skylight. He's maybe even looking to try and turn this man. He's got to be still careful. In fact, he's going to go down. Yeah. So a little bit too ballsy there. Got a little bit too ahead of himself with the IO.
Yeah, I think he expected the IO to have a bottle, so he actually aggroed and thought that he was going to get bottled up and that they could turn, but he just didn't realize that the Wisp doesn't have a bottle. He's not even rushing the bottle, and this is something I'm a little bit skeptical about. I mean, I played with EGM for quite some time, and he's one of those Wisp players that's played the hero hundreds of times, and he almost always says that going for that bottle is really crucial. It's really difficult to play the Wisp without it, so I'm questioning that decision a bit, but maybe they know what they're doing.
Yeah, we'll see. The side lanes at the moment pretty evenly going at the moment for Tiny and Gyro. Very close between the two of them. Mid lane, Thug giving it some to G here with the cold snap, but G, he has got that south, but still 17-9 against the 7-2. It is certainly a win for G in this mid lane as expected, and again, there's some more pressure going to be applied by VP as we see the Enchantress coming in for rotation.
Yeah, and even without this, even without the help from that Enchantress, G was already doing really well. Now the Astral setup,
Now I'm gonna Hadouken flying
through. Won't be close enough, but...
One more would do it, but they can't quite get it. They'll look to try and take Rubick instead, but Rubick actually able to turn it around, get them a kill on the Enchantress, so it ends up a 1-for-1. But I guess still, just the fact that they're creating this much usage against the Invoker is great for G's farming on top lane. Looking for Skylark. They're gonna be able to get in range for this. Still chasing it with the stick charges. Yeah, that's gonna be perfect. Stun from a Lower Dart sets it up.
Intent Bedrider. It's a quite difficult lane for the Bedrider when the Lion has a stick that early on, because every time, I mean, he's just gonna have a lot of spells in that lane, the Lion, if Bedrider keeps using Sticky. And with the stun and the Hex being as strong as it is early on in early levels, it's very scary for Bedrider to be in that lane. I expect him to just leave that lane and maybe give it to Rubick. And then the Bedrider will go into the jungle and try to farm his Blink.
I mean, talking about going into the jungle, are we getting to the point where the Invoker's got to think about leaving the lane, or is he still safe to try and find some farming? Because he's really struggling against this OD.
Yeah, seven, we saw him struggle last game, but this game he actually has a kill.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he's really far behind. G is more than tripling, almost quadrupling him in CS at the moment. And Tender Nice as well, being level 6 at the 4-minute mark. He's already halfway to level 7, so he's obviously having a really, really good lane. You can see he's at the same CS as both safe laners, so he's just free farming in his lane.
So, I mean, it feels as well, a lot of stuff is going to be down to what this Tiny can do. And in terms of the item build, so obviously the fact that it's Tiny in the safe lane rather than in the mid lane, he's got his treads. Well, he's going to try and go for a killer with the Sunstrike. The burst is going to be there. Nice play from Ab Finem.
Very good execution on that kill. It's not the easiest combo to pull off, Sunstrike into the Tiny stun toss. And he also has to hold that toss a little bit so that the Sunstrike actually connects.
Yeah, very, very nice play indeed. I mean, is this going to be, when you're playing the safe lane Tiny, do you still rush for the Blink, or are we going to see drums come out first?
Well, I think Madara is one of those players, he doesn't like to buy Blink that much, at least not as the first item, so I expect him to go, as you can see, he's going for the drums, so I'm not sure if he will actually go for the Blink after the drums, but I wouldn't be surprised if we saw him just go straight for Axe and then go a fighting, farming Tiny.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, with especially with the fact that he's got the eye to position him and Rubick and Batrider to set kills up and kind of bring them to him.
Yeah, then again, at the same time, a Blink in this game on the Tiny would be really, really nice.
Oh, some very squishy heroes.
He can, yeah, that Enchantress, the Tiny, I mean, the Enchantress, the Lion, and potentially the Void, if they had that Sunstrike, they're dead.
FNG. Maybe in a bit of trouble, he's got the time warp.
Yeah, and FNG learned from the last time that if he gets caught by that stun, then he's dead. He gets out.
And we can see, as you said, Batrider just trying to utilize the jungle. It's of course giving a lot of space for this Gyro. They're gonna have the Rubick head up and maybe see if he can find some levels, but he's gotta be very careful about revealing himself. There's a lot of heroes around here putting pressure onto this tier 1.
Yeah, they're probably gonna look to take this tier 1, but this Fade Vault is really annoying. Takes out, he might even get XP for both Centaurs. He does, he should be happy. At least one of them, and he drags the creeps, so he stopped this push with one creep wave, catapult, two centaurs, so well done by the Rubick.
Still though, G getting a huge amount in this mid lane, 42 CS on the OD, and G, we saw him putting in a lot of work in the game, first game on the Viper, but arguably, you know, on an OD he's going to be able to do much more and be a lot more volatile for the lineup, especially if FNG's able to hit these big chronos, who's himself very close to getting that level 6, and looks like they want to try for some action down here. G TPing into position, Aloha Dance ready to set him up, and Madara, you could have gone just a little bit too close, but oh, another stun! It's not going to reach him, and he's going to be able to walk it off, and at the end of the day, it's just time wasted for G, who came down there looking for a bit of action.
Yeah, that's quite rough for G. I mean, he's still far, far ahead of the Invoker. You can see there's already a 1.5k net worth difference at 8 minutes, which is a lot. But yeah, good for AF that they actually manage. There's three heroes down there and then they still get nothing. G is actually still lingering around this bottom lane, and they have placed this ward behind the tower, inch cutting the creep wave. So they are probably gonna look to take this tower. However, this gives space up to the Bedrider on the top lane. He's probably gonna Firefly the wave. pretty soon, or at least the next one, so that they can start dealing some damage to the tower. It's also gonna give him some, yeah, some much needed farm, seeing as he had a very rough start. And the Invoker is also now catching up in CS. We can see he's only 16 CS behind the OD right now, and he's also banging on that mid tower with his Forge Spirit.
He's very close to Midas as well. I could be in trouble though. Cooldown slow will connect, and now with the Rocket Barrage chasing this one out. He'll turn with the Sunstrike, the Cold Snap, trying to go for Yoki, but the stick charge is there. They'll find a kill onto Invoker. Rubick going for the stun. And oh, okay, Loa does, turns it straight around. The relocate from Io, bringing in the Tani, able to take off the Jar on the back lines now. Trying to see if they can pick up a second one. The toss forward, in goes Io, the stun from Adora connecting, and they'll find it. Double kill for Tani. Now, can they punish this Tani's aggression? FNG is there, does have a Chronosphere, but there's not really any damage behind it to back it up. They'll look for the easier kill as G and No Fear chase down the Io, leaving it a 2-for-2. So, okay, who's coming out on top there? Oh, look at the gold change. It's exactly identical. It's hard to call who's the real winner of that one.
Yeah, I just want to clarify that Wisp was actually not level 6 at that point. They had just rotated there, both of them.
Okay.
So, still good rotation by the Gyro catching out that Invoker, and also good rotation by the Wisp Tiny to be there and get that kill. And yeah, we saw the Invoker. He tried to turn and fight the Gyro, but there's just no way he can do it. And once again, we see this build without one point in Wex being a bit... I think it was the other series where the Invoker
went
down
to not having Wex. Yeah,
it can be dangerous, but you do get the double forge earlier. But we see here, G, he's almost doubling the Invoker in net worth. And this is at the 10-minute mark. That's not something you want to see at this point.
I'll try and for FNG there, but he's quick on the fingers, quick on the time warp. Avalanche won't catch him. And mid lane G, Aladdin smoked up. See if they can catch anyone out here. Looking to make a movement into the jungle. They want to try and find that Tiny.
Yeah, this is a hasted Odi with a bit booster at 10-minute mark. He's also level 9, so this could be very scary for AF.
I mean, on the plus, Spartan has got that relocate, of course, now. So we might see him able to save this. But I think, yeah, G's just trying to Astral the IO. Make sure that there's no backup for the Tiny. It's well played. Indeed, they find themselves that Tiny kill. Spartan unable to save them. And now Spartan could be the one to be punished as well. And really nicely done from G there. Doesn't go in straight away on the Tiny. Make sure he finds that IO first.
Yeah, I actually would have liked to see VP just go straight for Roche right there. I think they could have killed Roche by the time that the other heroes respond. When you have an Odin, he also just stole some intelligence, and you have that Enchantress who can tank the Roche. They could probably have taken the Roche, but they might be unsure about whether AFs have any vision around the Roche pit, so they might not want to go for it. Also, actually, G's orb is not maxed out yet. So just holding on with that, but I wouldn't be surprised if we see them doing Roche within the next 5 to 8 minutes. Going for the Aethos here.
Yeah, I mean, at this point as well, Scarlet with the blink. If they can get a pickoff with the bat, it will be nice. The Invoker's finally been able to finish off his Midas, but as you have been pointing out, VP, G, very much ahead of the game at this point, and they caught out the IO here. We'll see if he's able to tether across to anyone, but the stun's straight in. Perfect timing there from VP. And they'll pick off the IO, and it looks like this game, too, certainly going a lot better for VP, and G, he seems to have found his element again back on this OD. It's going great for him so far.
Yeah, I mean, we did see a similar score. I think it was 10-4 at one point in the previous game, but I feel like in this game, VP are in a much better position. They have... It's a quite clear advantage at this point. They're gonna have to eventually deal with the split push of AF from the Invoker, with Tiny, also the pickoff from Batrider, but I think we could see them take out early Roche. They already took out, after this tier 1 falls top, they're gonna have all the tier 1s, so go into Roche and then just maybe go for a kill or two and then start getting those tier 2s, and I think with the second Aegis they're gonna want a siege base.
Pings are coming out here from both sides. We'll see if they can fight, and Tiny is going to opt for the blink. Earlier on, we were talking about that, whether that would be the case this game. But I think also, I guess for the reason you said earlier, the fact that there are heroes that if you can find the positioning, you're able to take them out of the fight straight away with the combo.
Yeah, AF know that they're going to have to split this game, so
yeah.
They understand that for VP, they need to also start splitting to be able to counter their split. You know, they need to catch up heroes, and when that happens, there will be potentially opportunities for the Tiny to get kills with that blink. That said, the OD actually has Atos, so he does not really care that much about the blink. I think that this Wisp is now... he is going to be between a rock and a void.
At least they get the Aya, but that was... I guess it's always... He did have the blink, maybe they didn't. I didn't see that, but yeah, FNG a little bit slow with the chrono. It's always going to be hard to catch him. And looks like meanwhile, at the same time, mid lane, Yoku in a spot above her. Nice defensive Astral from G. But now Madara coming in with a stun, and he's going to find the kill. They'll turn around with a finger and a slap from G. And they will punish the Tiny's aggression. Now it looks like they're going to find themselves another one as well. Skylight's a fall. So even though VP don't find the Tiny up top, they end up getting the kill in the mid lane.
Yeah, and that missed Sunstrike actually ends up costing them Madara's life. He felt like he has to go in and kill that Gyro, Gyro having a bit more net worth than he does. So he felt like that was a necessary play, and yeah, he ends up paying with his life for it, so...
And this is the roast charm, as we can see, a lot of intel stolen by OD. So... I should have a good shot at this one, the side of Abfinim. It doesn't look like they're going to be in a position to fight. They are grouped up towards that mid tower. Pings are coming through. Are they going to try and do anything about this? It doesn't really look like they can.
I mean, at this point, I just think it's really hard for Adfinim to fight VP's lineup. His horse is going to die before they get there. The OD, we'll see if they end up actually catching anyone. I don't think it's going to happen. The Lion is almost up to his Blink Dagger, so the split push will be very difficult to pull off from Adfinim. If they have good vision, they can see the Lion coming, and one thing they have going for them is this ward up on the tier, on the top lane. This ward that was placed earlier, and yeah, so they also spot out VP's ward. This should, however, signal to VP that they know that there is a ward in that area, so they should be dewarding it relatively soon, or at least understand that there is vision around that area. But that ward is good, and we saw the Wisp place that previously right before he died, and VP not catching that can prove helpful.
Nice smart move here from the boys and up, and him teeping away from that top lane. As VP were coming in full force, the full 5-man there onto the top. Spotted indeed out by that warding done by Abfinim. 12 to 5. I mean, if you're Abfinim, how do you have to play this to kind of make sure you don't give up anything more to the side of VP?
Yeah, it's really scary. You need to split the lanes and then try to keep track of the VP heroes as much as possible. VP just picked up two Blink Daggers, so one on G, who also has the Atos, and then one also on the Lion. Rubick going to be fine here, I believe. He has another blink in 3 seconds.
Does he go for this?
Oh, he knows that the Rubick can astral him if he goes for it.
Okay, nice Relocate coming in top. Can they kill the Iron Time with the cooldown? They should have a good chance of it. He's trying to keep himself alive. Oh, with the toss, the Avalanche! Oh!
Wow.
Great play from Tiny, making sure that Aya can take him home safely.
Just off the mark on that Sunstrike, yeah. That was very close, and it could have been a very, very clutch play if they had gotten that, both of them getting out. I'm a bit surprised the Gyro, he didn't go in at all and try to do any damage after.
Yeah, one hit
I felt like he could have just one more hit, and the Wisp would have died, which subsequently would have led to the Tiny dying as well, because he would not have been able to escape, most likely. There were some heroes, I think, coming close there, but yeah, nice split push from AF right now. FNG is going to try to take a... some position here so that he can go in on them, but he doesn't have a Chrono Spear anymore, so it's gonna be difficult for him to catch anyone.
Oh, wow. Well, he's getting the top Skylight, he's been spotted out. Trying to look for a bit of fun in the trees. But a lower dance, Angie, quick for the punishment, and Madara looking for the combo, but ooh. Blink away just in time from the Lion, as he doesn't get caught out. The OD, though, needs to be a bit careful. In fact, no, they're still hanging around. They want to fight here. G just turns around, starts to punch. Sanities comes out of the finger as well. Destroys the Rubick. Look at the Hex onto the Tiny. Io trying to save him. And now, well, might be able to do it here with the toss. The Avalanche is not quite enough damage. The Madara is still alive for the time being, but G gets the finishing blow in. They're going to be able to finish off Spartan as well. By the looks of it, he's trying to juke this out, but G blinks forward. So does the lower dance. It's a double kill for the Lion. Everyone at this moment in time dead on the side of Abfinim. It's 17-5, and VP in game two, they're really hitting back hard, and this is going to be a hard one for Abfinim 18 minutes in.
Yeah, the Invoker did end up going down on the bottom lane as well to the Gyrocopter, and I think it was the Enchantress as well. Yeah, losing all their heroes at this point, I mean, this is looking like a really hard game for that Finem to actually come back into. They're always so far ahead right now.
Can they kill him a second time?
Gonna get the last, so...
Actually, can they kill him a first time?
They can kill him. Yeah, he's gonna be under the fire here, so he shouldn't be... Oh, he's actually able to blink because he's facing the right direction.
Oh, here we go. There's Tiny Io coming in. Now, can VP save? They've got a chrono. They have got a chrono onto two, and now with the cooldown as well. Oh, VP coming in from the backside. Geek still alive. He is going to get Avalanche with all the Rindication, bringing Tiny away. Astros himself keeps himself up. They've taken down Rubik on the back. They're looking for Thug. They're going to find it. It's a double kill for Yoku. Exceptionally clean play here from the side of VP, and now they're looking for more. They're chasing down Madara. He's got Spartan backing him up. Skylark hiding in the trees. VP forced them back. Really nicely done there. Just G's play on the OD being incredibly elusive, keeping his scoreboard clean. 8-0-5. And now they're jumping in for more. Skylark's going to be tethered up. Can this guy save him? There's not enough damage reduction in the world that's going to save you against this OD.
Yeah, so that relocate was a bit curious. I mean, the relocate was like running out. It was a relocate going back, yes. not a new relocate. So I'm curious whether the Tiny actually wanted to be relocated or not, because I think he. I thought he had the kill on that, on the OD, but yeah, going safety first, I guess. Tiny at least survives. Picking up a double damage at this point. Yeah, it's nice, but I mean, he doesn't have Axe, he doesn't really have any items aside from the Blink Dagger.
Well, this is...
G going for what I presume could be Lincoln's, could be Hicks, I guess. It's hard to say. Depends on how he wants to play the game. Yeah, Lincoln's is not bad at all against the Bat Batter. It's one of the few ways he could die in this game. And if he just stays alive with the next Roche, with that next Aegis, they will probably go high ground.
There's pings on this one lane. Tiny needs to be careful. He does have an IO with Relocate, though. He does have the IO to help him.
Got a lot of VP heroes around this bottom lane right now.
They're looking for them. And he's just gonna go for the straight TPs out. And again, it's a wise move from Adfinim.
Yeah, VP are gonna spot this out with the ward in the Radiant jungle. Tiny farming up the big camp. And at the same time, AF are trying to get this tier 1 top. And AF have some vision in their own jungle, so they might have spotted a few of these heroes from VP down there. So potentially they feel safe taking out this tier 1 and they do get it on the Invoker. Two more heroes are actually up there from AF, and maybe they will look to take a good position so that when the VP heroes rotate top to defend that tower, they can actually take out some of the heroes. I would like to see the Mount Everest ward from AF up in the Dire Jungle, so that they can see any heroes who are trying to come there, but I'm not so sure that they have any more wards to purchase right now. But it looks like right now they're gonna get a trade-off tier 2 for tier 2, which is... They should be really happy about that. Any trade that is not losing something for AF at this point is good. And they also actually have quite good push. I wouldn't be surprised if AF just try to take this trade and split push and hope that they can get more buildings than VP does. But FNG is already back at the base and Chronosphere is ready. He's level 11. And AF see that the Void is not showing on the map. So they back off. And good read here from AF. Understanding that FNG has already TP'd back.
Yeah, it's nice to see that even from behind, Adfinim, as you said, just very well aware of what VP's plans are and trying to make sure that they don't give up anything else at this point. I mean, the Tiny in terms of farm, he's still got quite a way to go until he's a threat to this Gyro and OD, because they are pretty far ahead. We can see him go for the Aghanims. I mean, he's going to have that in 1200 gold time. If he can get that for the next fight, and they can get an opening to jump in, then maybe they do have potential, but every time FNG with that Chronosphere, it is again quite an issue for Adfinim's lineup, surely.
Yeah, I'm thinking it's going to be really difficult for AF to actually teamfight. Like, in a straight-up teamfight, VP would have to miss a lot of spells for them to actually be able to take that teamfight. What they can do, however, is get that Axe and try to go for the split push.
Ooh, grabbing Yoku here.
That rather.
And now...
Cliff him.
Yeah.
Cliff the Gyro, who has the BKB.
You can see the combo being thrown in onto Nofear, but yeah, Yoki just pops the cooldown. Now there's three incredibly grouped up here around this choke point. They do have Thug as well, but Thug gets stunned up. Now Io will take the Tiny back to base, but Thug just gets dismantled by the godlike OD. Skylark TP's away. And it's just the Invoker going down, but again, it was our Finem jumping in onto Yoku, and yeah, they put him on the cliff for a short amount of time, but they're not going to kill him.
I still think that Advenom are somewhat okay. Obviously, they don't want to be losing their mid hero, the Invoker. I also think his Midas was off cooldown. But they did cliff the Gyrocopter, and he had to use his TP, and at the same time, they got relocated back to the top lane, so the Tiny is actually farming in the meantime, and the Gyro wasn't farming for a little bit of time, and like, at this point, AF, they can't be too greedy in what they want, you know? Anything they can get, they take it. So...
As you can see, Lower Dance, he's found his arms very quickly on the Tiny. That's quite a win rate. 86% of the lines that get those two items are winning lines. Yeah. I mean, we have certainly seen recently in a lot of tournaments that Lion, under the right hand, he is a very strong hero.
Yeah, and now this is the second Roche coming up. He has that Atos Blink, and now the Lincolns. He's gonna take that Aegis. They're gonna try to go high ground with this, I'm pretty sure. They're most likely gonna try to defend the push against AF one time, and then after that happens, they will start pushing. But this is the strategic part of this game where AF have to be very cautious with their split push. I would like to see the Bedrider potentially trying to split push with the Wisp Tiny, and then when FNG or someone else goes back to the base to try to catch them, they can try to catch that hero before he jumps. So they need to bring a ward with them, perhaps place it in the Dire base, and then whenever they see that one hero TP's back, they actually just go for the hero instead, so that they can force more rotations from the VP lineup, and then when VP's heroes are trying to TP out, they can relocate into the fight that will be happening on the other side of the map. So AF need to be ahead of VP in the movement, which is very difficult when you're this far behind.
And look at G here, he's ready to set something up. Thug, again, smart awareness, just getting himself out of there. Looks like, yeah, as well. Yeah, the Batrider isn't going to stick around either.
Yeah, good read here by AF, and this is kudos to this ward down, outside the, by the edge of the William jungle, spotting out the VP heroes so that he understands that they're coming. G could have actually probably initiated from behind because he did not know that G was there. And G also has the Aegis and Lincoln, so I don't think that there was any reason for G to be scared. I mean, initiating with an Astral is totally fine because Invoker can't blink out of it. At the same time, it's not really like they're losing too much from doing nothing. However, I do think that if anything...
Oh, it's a relocate. Ooh, who are we coming in for? Well, we're coming in for the line killing that. That's a nice clean one. Spartans are fine that top lane. Okay, Rubik. Well, this man is looking to be rather dead as G just lays into him with the arcane orb. Oh, if he can get himself out of this. No, not gonna happen.
Yeah, so still good.
Yeah, one more trade on the for line.
This
far
definitely
behind,
favors
yeah.
AF. I mean, you saw there you got it's set 577, but these numbers they don't always tell the truth about how much gold was actually given. So. Still good trade for AF, one support for one support, and we see that the Lion's sitting at almost 7k net worth while the Rubik is at 4k.
Yeah.
And yeah, so in this game, AF, they just need to try to trade buildings, and I mean, right now, Madara is actually farming really well.
I mean, what's he going for next? Does he go for the BKB, or can he afford to get a bit more right-click, like an AC?
I don't think
or?
He should go for the BKB. Okay. I feel like it's not the right choice up against this Void, and if he does go for the BKB, he just won't have enough damage, and the Wisp can't tether him while he's BKB'd. I would say AC or Moonshard. I wouldn't really mind him getting a Moonshard right now, then he could push the base really fast, so that if VP are ever fighting against the AF lineup, I mean, potentially Batrider, if he can manage to catch out some hero and then they can just cancel some of the TPs, AF can take the base really fast once Tiny hits level 16 and he gets that.
I mean
Hyperstone, whether it's a Moonshard or it's AC,
When you're a tiny with an eye pairing, at what point in the tiny's items with the eye do you have kind of damage to fight against backdoor protection? Like, what do you have to be insanely stacked, or will a moon shard and AC be enough to fight
it? I actually think that a tiny with a moon shard at level 16 with an IO, he should be able to slowly win against the backdoor protection.
Okay.
But I'm not entirely sure about that, but I think he should be.
Oh.
However, if they have a glyph, then it could all just be in vain. So.
We've been praising kind of Abfinim's awareness, but Thug just as it. That was a little bit greedy of him there, sending that close to the tier 2 and MVP straight in. As soon as a Loyal Dancer is going to catch up with the line, there's no hope for escape.
Yeah, and this is what happens when their vision is gone. You see now that when they had that vision up, it was okay for them to split push, but now I feel like unless they manage to get new vision up, they're just going to start dropping kills. So I would like to see VP get a gem so that they can start. If AF put up wards, they can start dewarding them so that they know that AF actually don't have vision, because then they will have to play so careful that the goal that VP are gaining will be just enough that they will be fine regardless of what happens. But yeah, right now it's tricky for AF. They need to get out on the map and place vision that is more offensive so that it can actually see what VP are up to. Not just this vision in their own near their ancient area doesn't really do much for them. And a bit curious about the BKB pickup by G.
BKB, you're not killing Aegis, this man.
And he has the link, and
he's super defensive.
I wouldn't mind seeing him go for something like a Hex or even Shiva's. I mean, Aegis just gone right there, and they smoke actually with that Aegis gone. Something that you don't see every day, but still thinking they're strong enough to fight even without that Aegis, but I wouldn't mind seeing a Hex on him. Then he can jump in, kill the tiny, perhaps Astral the Wisp, or you know, something along those lines. Even just solo pick off the Invoker potentially with the ult.
Pink's coming out from FNG, wants to try and go for the kill on this bottom lane. There's three of them at the moment. He's trying to get themselves out. He's holding onto the Chrono, but he's going to get comboed in. We'll have the time. Well, look at that. Bam. Where's the damage now, Tiny? Now, Matter? He's taken out of this one.
Yeah, and FNG hesitating there. He should have understood where the Wisp was relocating from. There was not really that many angles that he could have came from, so I think FNG should have been able to get that. And strange here, the Wisp. I don't know if it's actually possible to do that.
Well, time the TP.
Time the TP so that you're in the same frame and then you TP back to base. I really don't know if it's possible.
If that works, I mean, that would be perfect. Yeah, I mean, that indeed, that looked like what he was trying for.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, is it? Can that work?
I don't think I've seen it, but I really don't know, actually.
Yeah, timing the ending of the TP, so
I'll ask EGM.
EGM
might
have
the chance.
EGM would know. Yeah, surely not. I've never seen like, you know, you feel like you'd see a video of someone doing that, and people would be like, "Wow, look what he did!" I've never seen that being done.
Yeah, and now they actually have that gem, so they're gonna remove these wards from AF, and AF are just gonna have such a hard time split pushing.
Ooh, talking about AF though. They do get the lasso onto the end. We've got to see Madara, and he will take down the lion. There's going to be a cooldown from Yoku. He's moving in, looking at the tiny, and he's going to get the tiny kill.
Yeah, they're trading a carry for support. And I mean, even though I actually think that the gold might actually be favoring AF at this point, because just how far ahead. Oh, it's actually
it's close,
not.
But
it's
close.
It's kind of close.
Yeah,
I mean, trading a carry for support, it's still kind of close. But I mean, obviously, that's not what you want to do at this point.
He does have buyback at least this time, and we have seen indeed as worth to show the net worth how it has really leveled off at this point.
Yeah, and they are keeping up the split push at the top lane. What I want to see now is maybe AF can, if they either they wait for the tiny to respawn. I don't know if they have the time to do that. VP seem really hesitant about pushing the space for some reason.
No, we're looking for Doug. There's no Chrono for 20, but if he gets a few bashes, okay, not gonna happen. Spartan relocating in.
Yeah, quite strange also that Invoker didn't blink out. He definitely had the time there. He used the time dilation. I don't know if the Invoker had already used his blink, but he should have been able to blink out of that because he used time dilation, he blinked in before, and then he actually got to hit the Invoker. Wisp relocating in there, but yeah, what they want to do is just, I feel like at this point, their almost only chance of getting a favorable trade is just do some sort of beat a Rubik away and then cancel TP's with a Batrider or an Invoker or something and just relocate in with a Wisp Tiny and try to take base. The problem is that VPA have so many ways of dealing with this split push. Odie can catch them, Void can catch them, the Lion with the Blink Dagger, and the Elements.
Talking about the Void.
Yeah.
Ooh! Jeez, I mean, that TP.
Yeah, FNG seems to be hesitating quite a lot on this Void.
And maybe he's had a bit to drink. his reactions have slowed a bit.
Yeah, I don't know about that. Maybe he just feels like after this chrono he did in the Roche pit in the last game, he feels PTSD's a bit hesitant about making a similar mistake. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's understandable, but it's something you really don't want as a Void player. It's the thing is like this, what you have to understand is that you do miss chronos here, and you know, you're gonna make mistakes, but you can't let it get to you, you know? It's not
you're
the
still
end of the
world.
Yeah, it doesn't really matter. Just keep playing your game and, you know, you can make mistakes. It's fine. The thing is, if you let your mistakes affect you too much, that's when it becomes, you know, a bigger issue. I mean, everyone does, you know, everyone makes mistakes, and so you just need to not let it get to you. But still, VP very far ahead in this game, and G, I assume he's going for the Moon Shard here.
I mean, Tiny and I can't jump in on this, kind of. They're hiding the trees.
Yeah. Nah. I think he's gonna go for a Moon Shard, and then they're gonna go Roche. He's gonna eat the Moon Shard when they kill off the Roche, and then they're gonna push. I mean, I was thinking that they would actually push with the second Aegis, but they're playing it very safe.
Where's my pension?
I mean, Tiny and I are still hiding in the trees, maybe just waiting to try and relocate on someone from this position. Nah, they're just gonna TP out now. Too much time spent up there.
Yeah, and one good thing for AF is that they have actually picked up a gem on their own. So if they can clear out some of these wards from VP, it is gonna be a little bit easier for them to play, because if VP's map is also dark, it's gonna be a little bit more scary for them, and then they might hesitate a little bit more, which might give some breathing room to AF. But he also has to be really careful about not losing that gem on the Batrider.
And as you said, there we go, the quick rush.
And Odie picking up that Moon Shard. And eating that Moon Shard. Going to take the Aegis. She's on the Gyrocopter. I wouldn't even mind if they did it the other way around, because then they could just have the Gyrocopter siege the base. And the Odie can just sit back, wait. And if they go on the Gyrocopter, he can Astral him. And then it's very unlikely that he actually manages to die with the Aegis. And the link, I mean, with the BGB and the Lincoln Sphere. So if you had the cheese, it should be okay. But
forget the catch onto G, buddy. Yes, yeah, it's not really the target you want to do with that Aegis and, of course, the Lincolns anyway. It's going to be a hard one to control. Yeah, they're just blink themselves out. Avoid this fight for the time being. FNG moving forward. He has got that chrono.
They're pinging out the ward. Just saw that ward, so they're going to remove that. And BB might get a little bit frustrated at this split push, but this is, I mean, it's at this point, it's, they shouldn't really fear that much. It's kind of like, you know, a mosquito circling some lion or something. Then it's more annoying than anything else, yeah. Really, at this point.
Yeah, it's going to be hard for Appenham to turn it into something game winning. Yeah, when they're this far behind. And mid lane, PP, Aegis and Cheese, let's go for the push, and G jumps straight in. He is ready to take on anyone who dares defend this. At the same time, Madara looking for the top. And he's going to try for it with the eye. Fortification will come out, no fear. He's going to be the one to TP back, and it's actually going to be enough to force VP back in full force.
Yeah, and I really hope that the Wisp does not bring the Tiny at this point, actually. The Tiny should just be left alone up there, and wise decision. They force out the Glyph, they force a couple of rotations.
Oh,
Tiny actually
TP
does TP back now, because he sees, I think he saw one hero up there that was the Lion, oh, so
mid lane. They go in. Chrono onto two. Trying to kill the Tiny, and oh, that's big. Double kill for G. There'll be the buyback from the Tiny. They do have buyback available on the Rubick.
Yeah, and you see, this is what happens when Odie uses his R button. Enemies, they disappear from the map, and yep. Then using their money to get back into the map. Yeah, this is, I mean, AF really can't afford having stuff like this happen. Now VP can just play the economic game. They're just gonna be so far ahead. They know that AF, they can't really do anything at this point. They just bought back, so they can't really go farm. They know that AF, if they take one more fight and they die, there are no buybacks. And VP still had that Aegis, so VP are just playing this a very, very slow paced, and just trying not to make any mistakes. I think the last game got to them a little bit. They feel like they're the superior team, and losing to AF might have, you know, made them feel a bit bad, but taking it very slow in this game.
Can they find anything with the smoke? That's the question. Eyes on to NoFit. Energy's there as well. It's hard for them to find this kind of pickoff now. It really is, and it isn't going to be the case. They just can't jump in on either of these. They're going to head back towards the top. Now, revealing himself in lane, there is a void and a line in the tree line. Now, they're actually going to jump in onto Madara. They want to try and fight. FNG moving in. Chronosphere up in 1 second, Spartan. We'll get himself out of there, but now Yoku moving in onto the Invoker, gets fingered to pieces. Straight out.
And the Invoker was up there. I don't know if the Wisp could have actually relocated the Invoker out of the fight. Yeah, they're going to lose two heroes now, and I don't really see anything stopping VP from going high ground right now. The Tiny might try to cut a wave or two, but VP still have a creep wave. They have a Cure flying out, I think is an Axe.
Tiny might
get the Cure.
Ah.
But they spot out the Tiny at least. Invoker buying back, understanding that he has to do something about this push.
Tiny doesn't have a TP.
That's not.
Oh, there. He's going to be Cloud9. And in the meantime, I mean, the rest of his team are just falling down. The Chrono from FNG catching out Invoker on the back lines. There will be a defensive Astral. But they've lost the Rubik. They're going to lose the Invoker as well. Three down, Tiny. Oh, hello. Here he goes. Finally arrives back at base. But his team are all dead. He's got no one to come home to. He's all alone. He's going to live the rest of his lives in solitude. And, well, he's going to die as well now. That's GG. That really is GG. And as you said, it VP a little bit ruffled after game one's performance against Abfinim. And game two, they do take their time. 40 minutes in, Abfinim do hold on. But VP, they were just never behind in this one. And this is kind of the VP we've come to expect from the past. This is top stuff.
Yeah, very convincing win. I mean, they did play it slow, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, I wouldn't mind seeing them try to breach high ground earlier, but then again, you know, it doesn't really matter if they win in 25 minutes or 30 minutes or 40 minutes. You know, a win is a win, and that's pretty much all that matters here.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, geez.